attend those men our pleasure?
Aye, my lord, without the palace gate.
Bring them before us. You may leave us. Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
It was, so please, Your Highness.
Well then, now, have you considered of my speeches? Know you that it was he who held you most under fortune, which you thought had been our innocent self? This I made good to you in our last conference, passed in probation with you, how you were born in hand, how crossed the instruments, who wrought with them, and all else that might to half a soul and to a notion crazed say, thus did Banquo.
You made it known to us.
I did so, and went further, which is now our point of second meeting. Are you so gospeled to pray for this good man and for his issue, whose heavy hand hath bowed you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my liege.
Aye, in the catalogue ye go for men, as hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, shuffs, water rugs, and demi-wolves are all clept by the name of dogs.
Excuse me, but did you just call us dogs?
What?
I'm no mongrel, mate.
Settle down.
You heard him, he called us a couple of curs.
I was just making a point.
And what, pray tell, is a water rug?
Take it easy, chum.
Do you know what a water rug is?
No.
Well, it doesn't sound like a very nice dog to me.
Gentlemen?
So now we're gentlemen, are we?
We have business to discuss.
Aye, Mollies. That is why we are here.
Are you prepared to do the deed?
I am one, my liege, whom the vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed that I am reckless what I do to spite the world.
And what say you?
Not so bad. I mean, things could be worse. Huh? I'm just saying, I'm getting by.
Do you want this gig or not, you bloody fool?
I'm just being honest.
You've got to tell him what he wants to hear, mate. Otherwise, we're out of it.
All right. I'll get it.
Well?
I've got this burning in my stomach.
Stomach?
I think it might be indigestion. But it makes me mad, it does. Really mad.
All right, then. Know you that Banquo is your enemy?
True, my liege.
Don't think I ever met the blighter.
What?
Well, I'm supposed to take your word for it that he's my enemy.
That's right.
But how do you know?
I'm the king. That's how.
That's right. He's the king.
Oh, I don't know. He's never called me a bleeding greyhound.
Will you shut up?
Or a freaking demi-wolf.
Are we ready? Here.
We are, my lord. Perform what you command us.
All right, then. And though I could, with bare-faced power, sweep him from my sight and bid my will avouch it, yet I must not, masking the business from the common eye, for sundry weighty reasons.
What weighty reasons?
Jesus.
Weighty reasons indeed.
Pardon me, my liege. He's a good lad, but a little weak in the head.
That's right. All us mongrels are like that.
Are you troubled?
Well, he's pretty vague about the weighty reasons, but he wasn't when he called us dogs. No, he got down to specifics there, he did.
Oh, you shut your bleeding trap!
Cyrus! Are you resolved?
We are resolved, my lord.
Good. I'll call upon you straight. Abide within.
One moment. Your Highness.
What is it now?
What's your liege's preference for the modus operandi?
What?
How do you want us to do away with the general?
I'll leave that up to you.
Oh, well, that's all fine and good, but it would help if we knew your pleasure in the matter, so we're all on the same page.
Well, how do you normally dispatch your victims?
Let's see. We can run him through with our swords. That's always surefire, but it could get a bit messy, especially if we don't hit any vital organs the first go round. Then there's the garret round the neck. You know, twist, twist, choke, choke. That's a lot neater. But it's a bit more time and effort. And then, of course, there's always the L1.
What's that?
Well, first we conk him over the head with a cudgel. Then while he's lying there unconscious-like, we twist a chain round both legs and tie a big rock around the other end of the chain, see? Then we load him into a rowboat and go out in the middle of a nice deep lock and dump him over the side, rock first. He goes straight to the bottom and stays there.
It was like a lot of work.
That's true, but it's quite thorough and very clean.
I say we run him through.
Yes, I think swords would be quickest.
Well, now, in that case, I'm afraid we got a problem here, mate.
What is the problem?
I loaned my sword to my cousin Fred for the weekend.
What did you do that for?
He needed it to clip his edges.
Well, can't you get it back?
I could, but he's going to Inverness with the family for a few days.
Don't you ever plan ahead?
I'm sorry. But, look, I've got me cudgel. We can do the old 1-2 instead.
But I haven't got a cudgel.
That's no problem. I'll do the cudgeling and you can tie the rock around his legs with the chain.
No, I'm not lifting any rocks. Last time I pulled me back out, it wasn't the same for months.
So you expect me to do the whole job by myself?
Look, why don't we do it this way? You can cook him on the head with the cudgel and then when he's out, I'll run him through with my sword.
No, you can't combine the old 1-2 with the sword play.
Why not?
It's not professional.
Well, then you'll have to find yourself another sword, won't you?
Well, I've got my dirk, but a dirk isn't going to reach any vital organs, is it?
It will if you plunge it in deep enough to go right into his eye.
I'm not doing any plunging, mate. Not with my carpal tunnel syndrome acting up lately.
Will you shut up? I don't care how you kill him. You can run him over with a horse in court for all I care. I just want him dead.
Well, all right. But you don't have to yell about it.
I think we're done here.
Yes, my liege. We are ready. You can count on us. Banquo is as good as dead.
Good. When the deed is done, come around to the back of the castle. My servant will have your fee ready.
Fee? You mean no benefits?
Benefits?
This is a freelance job, you dick!
Lance? Nobody said anything about a lance. That's it. I'll quit. You can get someone else to be your bleeding water rug. I'm out of here.
A demonologist is the opposite of a priest. Necromancers only perform dark magics.
Well, that's a bit reductive, don't you?
Not at all. It's the natural order. Summoning the devil's allies is the antithesis of a priest, thus making them the natural enemy. A necromancer isn't necessarily consorting with the devil.
But it is right well stealing God's property by pulling up the dead. You don't think that that's a more heinous crime in the Lord's eyes? Demonology is essentially witchcraft. While problematic in its own right, it's not nearly as bad.
But demonology is not considered witchcraft. Witches practice witchcraft. Demonology is a completely different study.
I don't think I've ever encountered a demonologist. So point to him.
That's besides the point. You're basing your argument on semantics and terminology of dark magics, not on the cause and effect.
I'm debating from experience. When you've been around long enough, you pick up a thing or two.
Oh, you don't think I know a thing or two?
Trust me. If you encountered a witch, as I have, you'd know the difference. You can't reason with them. And you thought regular women were bad enough.
I've never even met a witch.
Of course I have.
And tell me, When was that?
Years ago is when I saw the witch. It has been long, but I will ne'er forget the way she cast such evil, fearful spells. I saw just how she turned the day to night, the way she called upon her pagan gods, the screams from all around that pierced my ears, the terror that she wrought with her dark spell.
Oh, is that so? It sounds as though you jest.
I say that it is so, and so it is. How dare you question me, you peasant fool?
I only ask since you are confident, and I wondered if you ever had a chance to meet a witch who in your sight has used such powers.
I have seen one, and I have watched with mine own eyes as she was burned alive.
You seem to know so much, that's why I ask, and have further questions if you'll indulge. I ask you then, have you with your own eyes seen a male witch?
Who is this boy? Who comes into this hall and asks such jests? Do you not know who it is you address?
I know too well that I address three thanes of varying renown. Thus I ask twice. A witch that is a man, have you seen one?
No.
Why is that?
Because they don't exist.
And why do you believe they don't exist?
Because a man cannot become a witch.
Who says?
All say.
Not I.
Why not?
Because.
And who are you to question what is known? For centuries it has been all agreed that women, with the evil they possess, are made to be witches.
But who decreed?
The King of England, in his books, decreed that pagan spirits only speak with those that hold a certain evil in their hearts, and thus the natural conclusion is that woman is the vessel of this curse, that witchcraft manifests only in them, the ones who are capable of such strife.
A single man who was born to be king? A one who does not know what it is like to be a woman, nor to be a witch? How then could he approve or disapprove that which is right and that which is so wrong? Why does he who is simply born deserve to say whate'er he like to say, while they who are but merely born, alas, must bite their tongue when someone calls them witch?
How dare you?
How dare you question a royal decree?
Who are you?
I am Malcolm the Fourth, King of Scotland.
Bullshit!
There's no Malcolm the Fourth.
There was barely a Malcolm the Third.
We all remember how that went.
And even if you were, tomorrow is Lulach's coronation.
Lulach is to be King of Scotland.
This peasant must be mad if he thinks he's supposed to be king.
Tell us, peasant boy, are you mad? How are you to be king?
Nay, I am not mad. And I, Lulach, would be king. He would be, if my claim were not better.
Your claim? He's the son of the last king.
We don't even know who you are. The thanes of the very nation you're hoping to adopt don't even recognize you.
How is your claim superior?
Tanistry.
Ha!
The system by which the next king of Scotland is chosen, paternal lineage is considered as well as rye damna, kingly material. Turns out if your grandfather was a Duncan II, your great uncle a Donald I, your cousin a Kenneth VIII, and you're a Malcolm IV, you can become King of Scotland. That's tanistry. The best royal male heir with a good claim can become King of Scotland, even if he's not the son of the last king.
Father.
My father was no one. But because of this made-up system created hundreds of years ago, I can have everything. This system designed to preserve legacy that just protects ego.
You should be thankful for this system. It has allowed Scotland to survive for this long.
And yet somehow, none of you see the problem.
With tradition?
With privilege. I'm not even from Scotland. My father was Scottish, but I'm not from here. The rest of my family is German, Romanian, Lux. And yet I have a claim to a throne that I don't deserve because a system has allowed me to succeed.
Then give it up, you imposter.
If you hate this so much, then leave.
You're no son of Scotland. Leave it to those of us who have protected it.
We made Scotland what it is.
And we'll be damned before we let you change it.
You see, it's not going to work like that.
Well, is that so?
I've been put in a position where I can fix this mess that you and my ancestors created. I have the privilege of changing something broken.
It's not broken. It's kept us alive.
It has kept us strong.
Scotland would be nothing if we hadn't built it.
It wouldn't be here without us.
You should be grateful for it. It's a system that you have clearly benefited from.
It's a system that deserves to be changed. It's a system that is outdated, a system that lets me succeed because of how I was born, not because of what I'm capable of. A system where I can become king and others can't even dream of it. A system where only women are evil witches, but men are benevolent wizards. Where injustice reigns, where coattails can be ridden to the top. A system that when I become king, I will tear down brick by brick.
You foolish, ungrateful peasant. It's given you everything.
You don't realize how good you have it.
Why? Why, if you have everything, would you give away your kingdom?
Because from the top of the mountain, I can let down the rope to help everyone up. Because someone else deserves a turn. Because there's enough for all of us.
Well, it's a good thing you'll never be king. The Thanes decide. It comes down to a vote, and you just lost ours.
That's right.
Hear, hear.
That's what none of you realize. It's already over.
Over?
Over.
You three Thanes are last to hear my news. That I am to become the king of all, the last who have not welcomed what's to come. You clutch and cling to that already past, and hold on to a world that is long gone. But we have left, while you look in reverse, to see a land that you once used to know. The other Thanes and I look towards the wind. And see the future that we all agree will see us all through to a better place. I'll see you three tomorrow at Schoon for my coronation. I hope you'll be on the right side of history.
Good morning, and welcome to the pandemic edition of... Tainted Love. I'm your hostess, Reagan Lear, zooming direct from just outside the nursing home where my father, King Lear, has been receiving state-of-the-art care. In this volatile political landscape, a breakaway literary sensation has emerged from an unlikely quarter. I Was Lady M is the searing memoir of one woman's dysfunctional marriage to a brutal mass murderer and her posthumous search for self, already in its third printing. It has been dominating the bestseller lists here and in America and flying out of Amazon warehouses from Rome to Riyadh. Today, it was also shortlisted for the coveted Man Booker Prize. The author of this publishing phenomenon is our guest this morning. This is the first time since the release of her memoir that she has spoken out publicly about her life, her death, and her spiritual recovery. Will you please join me and our Tainted Love musical maestro, Andrew Eggcheek, in giving a warm welcome to our show, the author of I Was Lady M, Lady Evelyn Cornwall Macbeth.
Oh, darling.
Amazing, Andy. Netflix original is set to begin production on I Was Lady M, starring...
Gwyneth Paltrow.
I love it. Thank you for joining us here today, Lady Cornwall Macbeth.
It's good to be here, and please call me Evelyn.
Evelyn, the book. Could not put it down. The story of your life and after had me completely riveted.
Thank you.
And a little repelled.
Well, that's as it should be. I didn't want to pull any punches.
You certainly can't be accused of that. Tell us, Evelyn, in a nutshell, what propelled you to write this memoir?
Well, it's all about choices.
Well put.
And I guess women's choices in particular, and my unique experiences offered me a perspective that might provide hope and inspiration to others.
Your story really is the stuff of Greek tragedy. Devoted wife and confidant of one of Scotland's most decorated generals, celebrated 12th century hostess, at ease in the highest echelons of power, had it all. What went wrong?
Well, that's not an easy question to answer. As I say in my book, it's never just one thing that scuttles a marriage. I couldn't get pregnant, his career had stalled, and we were constantly at odds about the cost of the kitchen renovation. Couldn't acknowledge our pain to ourselves, let alone to each other. Our desire for more. Oh, inner emptiness.
So what you're saying is, and I think there are many, many couples in our audience who can relate to that story, that all of it, the assassination, the coup, the installation of a brutal military regime, and the callous disregard for innocent life boils down to low self-esteem.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I think to give the critics their due.
Oh, by all means.
They would say that you were not just ambitious, but...
Go ahead, say it. Greedy.
Greedy and ruthless.
I know. I know. I know. Greedy, ruthless, depraved. But, you know, none of it was the real me. Because there was no real me. Who was I? Mrs. Macbeth. Ugh. I want people to understand that I was a roaring, raging drunk. I mean, by the end of the night, I couldn't know. I didn't know who I was trying to kill. Duncan, my husband, my father. But, you know, I suppose the good news is that I had started to reach rock bottom, but of course I hadn't seen it yet.
You state in your memoir that even now you can't be certain who dreamed up the idea of assassinating the king.
Well, are you married?
How long has it been, Andy? 15 years?
16.
Well, you start to believe that you can read each other's minds, right? And with my husband, who was a particularly poor communicator even before he started dabbling in the occult, it was understood. I would have to be the one to nudge things along if we were going to accomplish anything at all. But I don't want to get caught up in a he said, she said type of thing.
One of the more startling disclosures in the book had to do with your lifelong battle with your weight.
Yes, it's hard to believe that towards the end there, I was nearly 400 pounds.
So it wasn't blood on your hands that wouldn't wash off, it was...
Chocolate. Yes, that's right.
Speaking of the devil, I understand that part of your plea deal is a public service announcement. Do we have that queued up?
Hi, I am Lady Macbeth, speaking to you from an undisclosed location in the Highlands of Scotland. Now, many of you have wondered, what lessons, if any, does Shakespeare offer to common folk in the age of coronavirus? And I knew in a flash I could finally redeem myself and be of service to the community. After all, who better than me than to teach the masses on how to wash their hands? So first, for those of you whose hands have not been steeped in the blood of a murdered monarch, may I recommend submerging your hand in ketchup or barbecue sauce? That is, if you can find it on your grocery shelves. Otherwise, you will have to simply use your imagination. Pretend that you have committed a crime against humanity, and the evidence is on your hands. Next, with your preferred bar of hand soap, pears, and running water, lather up, remembering to scrub the tops of your hands between your little fingers and underneath your nails for at least 20 seconds. And if you grow tired of singing happy birthday, might I suggest, I'll never do it again. I'll never do it again. I'll never do it again. Rinse and repeat. Rinse and repeat. Rinse and repeat. Woo! Trust me, it doesn't get old. Okay. And remember, while soap and water will not wash away the guilt, it will free your hands from the virus that causes COVID-19.
Moving. And you've been retweeted, what, 400,000 times?
Oh, 465,000 times. But it's not vanity, it's just my OCD.
Tell us about your journey towards psychic wholeness.
The first 100 years or so seemed interminable because, you know, for the longest time, even after I was dead, I still wanted to kill myself. And I wish I could tell you it was because of my part in the genocide, but it wasn't. It was still all about him.
You were stuck.
Oh, very.
I must say, I found your description of those first years quite moving. Let me read briefly from the book. Oh. I had longed for death, and yet now that I had taken that irreversible step beyond the boundaries of the known world, I found that I might as well have stayed home in my pajamas. Mm-hmm. I was still sleepwalking through everything. Mm-hmm. Yet you persevered. Comment?
Well, I can't take credit for that. I had no choice in the matter.
Just how did things get moving again?
Until, about the 20th century, I had no peer group. I was on my own. Then, miraculously, other wives started to join. I mean, Joe's wife, Nadia Aluyeva, in 32, Eva Braun. But it wasn't until Eva Perón offered to be my sponsor that I began my recovery. She was tough on me, but there's nothing like another partner of mass murder to teach you on your stuff. She was such an inspiration to all of us, especially after Andrew Lloyd Webber made her a household word.
Speaking of which, a little Broadway birdie tells me you're in talks with Lin-Manuel about a musicalization of your life.
Oh, it's too early to assume. No. Now, of course, membership has exploded. Groups every night of the week.
And your group still meets?
Faithfully, 52nd year.
The work continues.
Well, we don't speak of a cure. Emotional setbacks, you know?
Do you have any contact with him?
Oh, God, no. They have another place reserved for him. I'm so embarrassed to say that I did try to reach out to him in the centuries, you know, until about 72. He never responded, just broke my heart. Then my group insisted I write down my side of the story. It was hard to imagine that anyone would be willing to entertain a different view of me and of the marriage. And
People can be so judgmental.
This memoir represents a kind of fresh start for you, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely. It's been a rebirth. I have to pinch myself to remember that I'm not alive.
Never expected it to cause such a stir.
Oh, no, absolutely not. A minor effort. Set the record straight for myself.
There were those who questioned the network's decision to interview you.
Yes, I'm aware of that.
They see this as your attempt to exonerate yourself, or at least gain a measure of undeserved self-sympathy for your, your crimes against humanity.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I've seen the emails. The ones from the UK were particularly hard to read, but you know, what else can you expect?
You seem pretty comfortable in your own skin.
Well, you know, I've had a lot of psychotherapy. And the medication didn't hurt either. And I continue to work the program. I've pretty much completed the searching moral inventory, making amends to those I've hurt. There are thousands. Will of course be my next challenge, but choices.
Well, good luck to you, Evelyn. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
And thank you. Tune in tomorrow when Marie Antoinette will give us her recipe for sachet tarte.
It's hot in here. This door! What craftsmanship! Look at all these little baby people!
Oh, it's you!
I don't suppose you could tell me how to find my way out of you. Man, you are one scary looking dude.
So you're the identity thief.
Hey, man. I'm just a porter for a thing.
I am not a man. I am a monster. And you were a porter, but not here.
Shit. Is this... Am I being fired?
Are you drunk? Like, still? Or are you just stupid?
Yeah, gonna say still drunk for that one.
Do you know who I am?
Fido, Fluffy, and Spike.
Now that's just being speciesist.
I'm sorry, I don't know who the hell you are.
Oh, hell, you at least know where you are.
Shit. Is that why it's so hot in here?
I've been waiting for this day. Trying to convince the fates to cut you down here sooner, but they promise you drink yourself to death pretty quickly. So are you or are you not the porter who claimed to admit souls in the name of Beelzebub? In the other devil's name?
This is about the devil porter bit.
Of course it is! I'm the true devil porter.
Oh, well, you're certainly more physically suited to the job, I'll give you that.
You've been impersonating me to mortals for long enough.
Whoa, you gotta understand, this is... Wait, this isn't Christian hell, is it?
Christian hell? Do you mean the area of hell we reserve for Christians who use their faith as a means to justifying the persecution of the vulnerable?
Huh. No. Although it's pretty progressive you have that.
Even though you died in 11th century Scotland, hell is eternal. Okay, so we've got the fates to see through the future and all that. So we decided to section off some of the real estate early for those who use so-called religious morals to persecute others. Yada, yada. It's really not that interesting.
Hey, does that mean you know what it's like to be a porter in the future?
In Scotland?
Sure.
How far in the future?
1,000 years from now?
In the 21st century, you are now called a doorman, and drinking on the job really isn't allowed.
Oh, what do they do then?
Listen to a radio?
What's a radio?
Oh, it's like a box of-
Wait a second! You got me off my point! Have you or have you not claimed to be a devil porter to the mortals during your lifetime?
Only as a joke.
I don't find identity theft very funny.
Oh, come on! Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? Faith, here's a farmer that hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Come in time. Have napkins enough about you. Here, you'll sweat for it. How are you not dying at that?
I'm immortal.
No, it's a figure. Well, how do you not find that funny? A farmer who's hanged himself because prices are going down. He's miserable because there's too much food for people to eat. That man is going straight to hell.
That's devastating. A man whose self-worth is defined by his ability to sell goods for a higher price because there's a lack of them?
Maybe it's a you had to be there sort of thing.
Beware! Oh! Locked in the devastation of a capitalist system that doesn't protect agricultural workers and in fact encourages them to produce less, therefore leading to artificial food scarcity?
Jeez, did somebody say buzzkill?
You must realize that when you impersonate me, Cerberus, spawn of Echidna and Typhon, guardian of the gates of hell, the true devil porter, as you so pedestrianly put it.
All right, wait. This one'll get you. Knock, knock.
What was supposed to get me? I don't get it.
Oh, come on. When I say knock, knock, you say who's there, right? Knock, knock, who's there? Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Here's an equivocator that could swear in both the scales against either scale, who committed treason enough for God's sake, yet could not equivocate his way to heaven.
These are perhaps witty, but not exactly ha-ha or laugh out loud funny.
Oh, come on! If you're the true devil porter, how many people have tried to lie their way out of here, huh? I mean, they come in and try to equivocate. They've spent their whole lives lying up and down, and then they get to hell and, oops, can't equivocate any longer. Can't lie your way out of this one! Well, all right, have you heard the one about hell being hot enough to roast a goose?
I don't know if you could understand this as someone who was mostly known for drinking cheap liquor and making unfathomable jokes, but I have a bit of a reputation down here.
I drink reasonably priced liquor, and I have a reputation up there.
Oh, sweetie. No, you don't.
Anyway, it reflects poorly on me when mortals are acquainted with you before they get the chance to meet me. You know, at these, the gates, the actual gates of hell?
I'm not following.
People used to be terrified of me. I am a three-headed dog beast. You should be trembling in my presence.
Yeah.
I don't really do.
As I was saying, people used to be terrified of me.
And now they just laugh. They're all like, oh, you're the porter from Macbeth's castle. I guess I made all those Englishmen's pants a little too small after all.
Well, if anything, it sounds like I've been excellent for softening your image. Okay, very clear. So I'm really dead then?
Very rarely do people make it down here alive.
Well, all right. If I'm dead, then why am I still drunk?
Presumably, you drank yourself to death. It'll wear off soon.
Well, all right. Let me level with you, dog monster.
It's Cerberus.
Right. Cerberus. Didn't mean to be speciesist.
Cerberus. I feel like you're saying it as two words, but it's just one word, okay? Just Cerberus. Like Madonna!
Virgin Mary?
Oh no! I made a reference outside of your timeline!
Oh, you had to be there!
No, that's not what this is.
Well, Cerberus, it seems we've reached an impasse.
What do you mean? You're dead. It's annoying that you tarnished my image, but now you get to burn for eternity once you're through these gates.
Eventually, no one will remember the portal.
Well, that's just it. It seems that my jokes, whether or not they made sense to you, have made enough of an impression that some people have remembered me. Which makes things a little bit trickier for you.
What are you getting at?
A deal. You let me live a little bit longer, and I'll start performing you with a little more accuracy. I won't try to amuse people. I'll go for real fear.
I'm listening.
That way, people will tremble to see you because they've already become terrified of me. The only thing is, I can't do the job from down here. You see, I've got to be alive, which means I've got to get back up there to redeem your good name.
I understand. Be gone then. I, Cerberus, release you.
So, is it this way, or... Nope, that's the hellfire. Right, okay, not that way then. All right, no, that looks terrible as well. How do I get out of here?
Do you get it?
I just got you! The look on your face!
So I'm guessing it's not as easy as the first one past the gents, so that sort of...
Oh no, but you thought it was... I've never laughed this hard in my life.
How do I get out of here?
Oh, I can't just let you out. I guard the gates of hell. One job, to keep mortal souls from escaping. I can't just let you go back up there.
No one will remember the porter. I'll be fine. I think it is time for you to head through the door.
No thanks.
I'm sorry, what do you mean no thanks?
You know, I've been thinking. Maybe I'll just stay right here and devil porter with you. I do have the experience.
No, you can't. There's just... There's
we'll
no
make
for
a great
guard.
Team. You can scare them out of their wits. I'll tell them knock-knock jokes. We'll both usher them inside.
But you're mortal.
Oh, now who's being speciesist? No, I think I'll just settle in for a nice warm eternity.
Fine. If you're fine, I'm fine.
Oh, there was a bonny lassie. And she lived in Creef.
she went into a butcher shop where he was selling beef. He's kin to her the middle cut, soon she did fall, and the wind blew the bonny lassie's lady off. Oh, the wind blows east, the wind blows west, the wind blows the bonny lassie's lady off. Oh, the beef was in her basket.
It's a left, then another left, then a right, then straight through the door. You cannot miss it.
Yes! Thank you!
Who's so, that? Stop it right now!
Get you away were fun, from
not
me.
Anymore! Stop!
Alright. Off I go! I pray you remember the poor.
I despise mortals.
Bells that summon. Halloween, early evening. A house in the suburbs. It is a stormy night. Thunder is heard in the distance. Lewis is sitting in the kitchen at the table, staring at a laptop. Papers are scattered on the table. Maddie enters with a platter of cookies and two cans of soda.
Here. Food for thought.
Thanks.
Hey!
Food for thought. What have you got?
Nada.
Lewis, get serious.
I wish we were at Ben's Halloween party. Even my parents are partying. Can't I just wing this?
No, you can't just wing it. The stakes are high.
You don't have to remind me. Hey.
Let's see what we have here. What the hell is this? Random doodles and... Wait. Is that a drawing of a penis? And nothing here either. Okay. Listen, the speech is tomorrow, and you need to do well or that jackass jock is gonna win. And you know what that means. It means that you don't become student council president.
Yeah, I know.
And how are you gonna get into Harvard if you don't have some sort of edge?
I should have stayed on the crew team.
Well, it's too late for that.
Yeah, you don't have to remind me. I never hear the end of it from my parents.
I'm on your side, Lewis.
I know. I have a plan.
What is it?
What if I...
Destroy him.
Destroy him?
Yeah, destroy him.
Whoa, I mean, that's a little bit extreme, don't you think? I mean,
do you want to win or don't you?
Of course I do.
Then do what it takes.
Maybe they'll just go away.
God damn trick-or-treaters. Go get them. Go get
them. Why me?
I'm busy plotting how you can destroy Duncan.
But...
Go!
Okay. What happened to Trick or Treat?
Hail, Lewis!
How do you know my name?
Lewis, you will be president!
Hey, you're never going to believe this.
No time for that.
No, these three witches told me that I'm going to be president.
What?
That's what they said. These chicks in witch costumes.
Are you sure they said that?
Yeah.
Do you know who they were?
No.
Weird. I don't know. Let's get back to work.
Okay. Where were we?
I dug up this dirt on Duncan.
Oh, Jesus Christ, Maddie.
You want to win, don't you?
This is too much. How did you find this?
I have my ways. Let's just say that nothing ever dies on the internet. We gotta use this.
I don't know, Maddie.
Damn it, Lewis, grow a pair.
Oh, but this is...
You gotta become Stuco president. That's your ticket to Harvard.
Well, it must be nice to be a recruited athlete like you.
You're gonna use this. You're gonna do what it takes to win. You can't afford to lose.
Can we just like sit on this for a little bit and think about
it? The election is the day after tomorrow. It's now or never. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Do it for Harvard. Do it for me.
Look.
Jesus Christ.
This is your turn.
No way.
I gotta finish reading the rest of this stuff, so you go.
Fine. Here you go. Hey.
Keep your hands clean.
What the hell?
What's up?
Some kid dressed up as a ghost just threw this at me.
That's weird.
Yeah. Said keep your hands clean and then left.
A public service announcement on Halloween?
I don't know. So, you ready?
So, what do we do with this?
We share it. It'll spread like wildfire.
It'll destroy him.
Cost of doing business.
So, if we post it now, you think he'll drop out of the race?
That's the plan.
I don't know. I mean, this will destroy his family, too.
Screw your courage to this sticking place and will not fail.
Wait, is that on our English test tomorrow? Oh my gosh, I gotta study.
Come on, you know Macbeth.
It's easy for you to say, Miss Harvard. Me, on the other hand, my dull brain is wrought with things forgotten.
Nice, for Macbeth. Okay.
Wait. But do you really think that we need this? You don't think that I can win without it?
Lewis, I love you, but Duncan is the 6'4" captain of the varsity swim team. He's been the lead in the last 3 musicals. He's a freaking Adonis, and he's been president for the past 2 years.
Gee, I mean, thanks for believing in me.
No, I do. It's just, we gotta shift the odds in our favor, control our fate.
I guess so.
You can't be all wishy-washy about this. You gotta take him out, crush the shit out of him.
You really don't think I stand a chance otherwise? Okay.
Just do it.
I will. I'm
here, I'll do it for you. For God's sake.
You go.
No, I went last time.
I'm sorry. Nature calls. I'll be back.
You're so annoying. Hey.
Oh.
Hey, stop that.
Oh. Ow, Spot. Oh. Damn it, ow. Oh. Come here, Spot. Oh. So sorry.
Hey, what's up? what did I miss? Okay. Oh, Jesus Christ. You know, maybe they'll just go away. Or maybe not. God. Oh, okay. I guess I'll go get rid of them. Hey, what the F is this? So strange. People are really messed up. Like, some psycho just threw this at me. Couldn't even see what it was.
Oh my God.
Maddie, what's going on?
Duncan, do not.
it says Duncan Donuts. Maddie, you need to go get your eyes checked.
Unnatural deeds breed unnatural troubles.
What? Look, like, I don't know what's going on and why you're quoting Shakespeare again, unless there's a test tomorrow, but this is just
no.
A random box of... What?
This is a sign.
What?
They're all signs. The doorbells, the witches, the hand sanitizer, the dog, and now this.
I'm not following.
Everything is telling us not to do it.
Not to do what?
Not to destroy Duncan and push him out of the race.
Okay, so I think you're making a big deal out of nothing. It's just a bunch of weirdo trick-or-treaters, that's all.
No, it's more than that.
No, it's not. Look, hey, it's been a strange night. All this crap is messing with us. Confusion hath made his masterpiece. Hey, maybe I won't fail this test after all.
I'm not crazy.
Of course not. So?
No.
Come on, Maddie.
You're gonna win fair and square.
I thought that you said that I couldn't win on my own. That's why we dug up the dirt on Duncan.
It's not worth it.
Why?
I don't want this hanging over us, haunting us.
I really want to win.
I know, and I'll help you win, the right way.
You think I can?
Give it your best shot, and if we do the right thing, then we won't lose sleep over it.
You're probably right.
I'm always right. Trust me, if we post this, it'll be over for Duncan and his family. And what's done can't be undone.
Okay.
Oh. These stupid pics from Ben's party. Snap's so annoying.
Yeah, it looks like everyone's having a blast. Snap, ugh. Lots of pictures of Duncan. Quite the party man.
Don't worry about that. I'm gonna go to the bathroom, and then we'll get started on your kick-ass speech for tomorrow.
All right.